Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. These are the list of articles chosen for today's analysis. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping for the displayed articles is given in the description box below. And for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Let's move on to the first article analysis. This news article talks about the initiative taken by two Adivasi farmers in the semi-arid tribal land of Adilabad district in the North Telangana. The two farmers have established polyhouses for cultivating horticulture crops, and they claim that the polyhouses saves the crop from damage which is caused by birds and dust, and they claim that the polyhouses also protects the crop from diseases. So in this context, let us see the concept of polyhouses and its advantage and disadvantages. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, the polyhouse is one of the modern farming methods that uses controlled environment for the growth of plants. A polyhouse is a house or a structure that is made of transparent material, polyethylene. In this picture, you can see the polyhouse that is covered with polyethylene. Now, in a polyhouse, the plants are grown under well-controlled manner. But the size of the structure of the polyhouse varies from small sheds to industry-sized buildings according to the purpose. But now you may have a doubt that the description of polyhouse is like the description of greenhouse. So what is this greenhouse? A greenhouse is a broader term. If you are using glass, then it is a greenhouse farming. If you are using timber, then it is also a greenhouse farming. And polyhouse farming is one type of greenhouse farming styles where polyethylene is used as the cover. Now let us see how the greenhouse or polyhouse works. Before that, you should know the concept of greenhouse effect. The greenhouse effect is a process that occurs when gases in Earth's atmosphere, such as carbon dioxide, traps the sun's heat. This process makes Earth much warmer than it would be without an atmosphere. Now, this is what happens in the greenhouse or polyhouse also. See, in a greenhouse farming method, semicircular shaped structures that are made of transparent materials like glass, polyethylene, and other transparent materials are used. The semicircular shape is to allow the light penetration and for maximum coverage. What happens is, in the daytime, sunlight shines into the greenhouse and it warms the plants and it warms the air inside. And at the night time, it is colder outside, but the greenhouse stays pretty warm inside. That's because the glass or the polyethylene materials of the greenhouse trap the sun's heat. Now, in this, you should note that in the daytime, sun is the source of heat, and in the night time, surface is the source of heat. What happens in the greenhouse or the polyhouse is that at the night time, when the surface releases the heat, the greenhouse or the polyhouse traps the heat inside the house itself. And that is why even in the night time, greenhouse stays pretty warm. So the greenhouse or polyhouse controls the temperature. Now, apart from this, the greenhouse farming is also helpful in maintaining the right carbon dioxide levels and humidity or moisture level inside the structure. Now, some of the crops that are cultivated in polyhouses include papaya, strawberry, cabbage, spinach, tomato, and even some flowers like marigold, orchid are cultivated inside the polyhouses. So what are the advantages of polyhouse farming? First, polyhouse is economical compared to the glass house or greenhouse, but the greenhouse is more durable than the polyhouse. And then secondly, if you see, the polyhouse or the greenhouse protects the plants from the harsh external environment. They also serve as good shelters for rain. Then insect pests and diseases are less in polyhouses. And it is said that quality of produce is high in polyhouses compared to the open cultivation. And then polyhouses also make the fertilizer application very easy, and it is controlled automatically with the help of drip irrigation or sprinkler irrigation. One of the major advantages of polyhouses is that marginal farmers who are having small land holdings can take the benefit of greenhouse farming by use of low-cost bamboo greenhouse or even the polyethylene greenhouse, which is the polyhouses. Now, beyond these advantages, this type of farming even has some disadvantages. One of the chief problems in this type of farming is ensuring the nutrient availability and protecting the plants from the deficiency of various minerals like boron, nitrogen, phosphorus, calcium, iron, and potassium. And similarly, plants may also suffer from excess of nutrients. So this type of farming requires constant monitoring and soil testing to ensure that the plants get adequate amount of nutrition and they grow properly.
As a conclusion, we can say that the greenhouse farming in India may seem as a costly process, but however, there are many states and their horticulture departments which encourage polyhouse farming by providing different subsidy schemes. And this news article which we are discussing today mentions about one such subsidy that is provided by the horticulture department in the Adilabad district for the polyhouse farming. And this has helped the two Adivasi farmers. So that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about polyhouse, the comparison between polyhouse and greenhouse. And then we also saw about the advantages and disadvantages of polyhouse. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The display practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, which is based on this news article. This news article is about the recently released Freedom in the World 2020 report. Now, this report is released by a US-based NGO named as Freedom House. And this report is titled as Leaderless Struggle for Democracy. So in this discussion, we'll be discussing the present situation across the world regarding democracy. Then we'll see some important findings of the report. Then we'll also see some India-related findings and also the recommendations given by the report to strengthen democracy. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. First, let us discuss the present position of democracy in the world. According to this report, democracy and pluralism are under assault across the world. The report points that not just dictatorial leaders, but even the free elected leaders are also repressing the domestic dissent or disagreement. And this could be even seen by citizen protests that happened in the world last year. Like in Bolivia and Haiti, people protested against the compromised elections. Then the political demonstrations in Hong Kong against the China's interference in their internal affairs were met with police violence. And also, as we know, even our country is witnessing huge protests against the policies of the present government, like Citizenship Amendment Act and NPR, etc. So like this, there are and there were many protests in the world. Now, as a result of all these happenings, the report found that global freedom has declined consecutively for the 14th year. According to this report, in 2019, individuals in 64 countries experienced deterioration in their political rights and civil liberties, and only individuals in just 37 countries experienced improvements. Now, what is worrying is that not just authoritarian states, but also democratic governments are repressing on its ethnic, religious, and other minority groups. So in this way, let us discuss the findings of this report. Now, this report is mainly based on two indicators. As we already saw, one is political rights and the other is civil liberties. And based on the score, the countries are divided into free, partly free, and not free countries. And this report assessed 210 countries and territories across the world. And it found that out of 210 countries and territories, 84 are free, 67 are partly free, and 59 are not free. And the report is fiercely critical about the world's two largest democracies, which are nothing but India and the US. According to this report, the leaders of these democracies are willing to repress the institutional safeguards and they are willing to disregard the rights of critics and minorities to pursue their populist agendas. So as a whole, where does India stand? As we know, India is the leader of the region when it comes to democratic values. So as per this statement, even this report states India enjoys the free status. But still, the report notes that India's commitment to pluralism and individual rights are under threat under the present government. It is because India's score has declined in the year 2020 from 2017. This year, India's score is 71 out of 100. If you see in political rights category, India scored 34 out of 40. But in the civil liberties category, India's score is just 37 out of 60. And this is the reason why India has been listed as one among the bottom five countries in the free category. Other than India, the other countries which are in the bottom five of free category are Botswana, Peru, Timor-Leste, and Tunisia. And if you see, most surprisingly, all the top performing countries in the free category are from Europe. They are Finland, Norway, Sweden, Netherlands, and Luxembourg. Now, coming back to India's score, this report has given a reason for falling score of India. It states that certain policies of the Indian government is the reason for the falling score. It says that the present government's policies are based on Hindu nationalist agenda. And this agenda abrogated the rights of different sections of its Muslim population. So this threatens the democratic future of our country. And as you can in this picture, this also lists some other setbacks in our country with regard to political rights and civil liberties. Like you can see localized internet shutdowns, then the controversial citizen register, etc., etc. But if you note this picture, you can note that the union territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh have been shown as separate territory. And this is one of the unacceptable elements in this 2020 report, because it treats this region as Indian Kashmir and it treats the Indian Kashmir as a separate territory. This report mentions that this region witnessed several untoward events, such as revocation of the autonomy, which was provided under Article 370, and then dissolution of the local elected institutions, then heavy security crackdown, which curtailed the civil liberties of the people. And it also resulted in mass arrest and detention of local politicians and activists. And because of these reasons, the status of the region declined from partly free to not free. So even though this report has treated the Jammu and Kashmir Union Territory and Union Territory of Ladakh as a separate region, as a whole, if we say, a part of our country is under the category of not free countries. But as a whole, India is in the free category. And if we consider our neighbors like Pakistan, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh and Sri Lanka, they are in the partly free category. And then other neighbors like China, Myanmar and Afghanistan, they are in the not free category. Then among the BRICS nations, China and Russia are under the not free category. But Brazil and South Africa, along with India, they are under the free category. And if you see the region-wise analysis of the world, then all the countries in the America and most of the countries in Europe, they come under the free category. And majority of the countries in South America, they also come under free category, as you can see in this map. And in Africa, except for few countries like Tunisia, Botswana, Ghana and South Africa, majority of them are under not free and partly free categories. And as you can see here, a vast majority of the countries in Asia are under not free category, which is depicted in purple color. So this is the situation of freedom in the world. So this report has given certain recommendations for safeguarding the political and civil liberties of the people. Firstly, it has asked to respect, protect and fulfill the human rights. Then it has asked to strengthen public support for democratic principles, and it can be done by investing in civic education. Then another suggestion is to guard against the manipulation of open democracies by authoritarian actors, and it can be done by fighting the manipulation of media and social media, then by preventing interferences in elections, and also by strengthening laws that guard against foreign influence over government officials. In addition to this, the report also suggests certain measures for defending democracies around the world. The report suggests to support democracy in both word and deed as a key pillar of foreign policy. And this can be achieved by emphasizing democracy, strengthening programs in foreign assistance. And it can also be achieved by supporting civil society and grassroots movements that are calling for democracy. And it can also be achieved by investing in alliances with other democracies in multilateral institutions. And support for democracy can also be achieved by imposing targeted sanctions on individuals and entities who are involved in human rights abuses, violations, and who are involved in acts of corruption. So these are some of the measures suggested by the report to safeguard democracy as a whole and then to safeguard political rights and civil liberties of individuals. So that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the Freedom in the World 2020 report. We saw some important findings related to India, and we also saw some recommendations to strengthen democracy. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The respect practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion. This discussion is about the agro-processing cluster scheme, which is the Pradhan Mantri Kisan Sampada Yojana. So in this discussion, we'll discuss about the news today and we'll also see about this scheme. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. The news article mentions that the Inter-Ministerial Approval Committee has sanctioned 10 food processing projects that are worth 301 crore rupees. This Inter-Ministerial Approval Committee meeting was held under the chairpersonship of Union Minister for Food Processing Industries. And these projects were sanctioned under the Agro-Processing Cluster Scheme, which is the Pradhan Mantri Kisan Sampada Yojana. Now, among these projects, the committee approved 8 projects in Tamil Nadu, and these projects are spread over 8 districts of Tamil Nadu, and it is worth 230 crore rupees. Now, what government is doing is, through the Ministry of Food Processing Industries, it is making all efforts to encourage investments in the food processing business. And one thing that you should know here is that in our country, 100% FDI is permitted under the automatic route in food processing industries. Also, 100% FDI is allowed through approval route for trading, including e-commerce in respect of food products manufactured and produced in India. Now, the projects sanctioned by the Interministerial Approval Committee are likely to generate employment for 10,000 people. These projects envisage the creation of direct and indirect employment for persons, and it also aims to create employment opportunities in rural areas. And these projects will also benefit nearly 40,000 farmers on a whole. And if you see in Tamil Nadu itself, these projects are likely to generate around 8,000 jobs, and it will benefit 32,000 farmers. So, in this context, let us discuss about the scheme, which is the Pradhan Mantri Kisan Sampada Yojana. Initially, the scheme was known as Sampada, which stands for Scheme for Agro-Marine Processing and Development of Agro-Processing Clusters. But it has now been renamed as this PMKSY. And this scheme is implemented by the Ministry of Food Processing Industries. And it is a central sector scheme. This scheme was launched in 2017 for a period of 2016 to 2020. And this scheme is a comprehensive package which aims to create modern infrastructure with efficient supply chain management from the farm gate to the retail outlet. And the objective of this scheme is to supplement agriculture, to modernize processing and to decrease agri-waste. So this scheme aims to create modern infrastructure for food processing such as mega food parks or clusters and even individual units. It also aims to create effective backward and forward linkages by linking farmers, processors and market. Now, in this, the term backward linkage is used to indicate the kind of interdependency of a particular industry with the upstream sectors from which it purchases its intermediate inputs directly or indirectly. And the term forward linkage is used to indicate the kind of interdependency of a particular industry with the downstream sectors to which it sells its intermediate inputs directly or indirectly. And apart from this, the scheme also aims to create robust supply chain infrastructure for perishable products. So this type of scheme provides a big boost to the growth of food processing sector in the country, and it also helps in providing better returns to farmers. This scheme is a big step towards doubling of farmers' income and also a step towards creating huge employment opportunities, especially in the rural areas. Then it is a step towards reducing wastage of agricultural produce, then increasing the processing level, and also it is a step towards enhancing the export of processed foods. So this scheme has a major positive impact because it is an umbrella scheme. Now we are saying it is an umbrella scheme because it incorporates other schemes of the ministry such as the Mega Food Parks Scheme, Integrated Cold Chain and Value Addition Infrastructure Scheme, then Food Safety and Quality Assurance Infrastructure Scheme, then Human Resources and Institutions. Now these schemes were already implemented under the Ministry of Food Processing Industry, but after this Pradhan Mantri Kisan Sampada Yojana was launched, these schemes are now implemented under this umbrella scheme. Now in addition to these schemes, some new schemes were also incorporated, like infrastructure for agro-processing clusters, then creation of backward and forward linkages, then creation or expansion of food processing and preservation capacities scheme. Now, all these schemes in themselves have their own modalities. We'll discuss about these schemes elaborately in some other day. Today, just know that all these schemes are under the Pradhan Mantri Kisan Sampada Yojana. So now, to give boost to the food processing industries, the Interministerial Approval Committee has sanctioned 10 food processing projects in the country, and 8 of them are in Tamil Nadu. So that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the Pradhan Mantri Kisan Sampada Yojana and the objectives of this Yojana. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. Moving on to the next discussion, this news article mentions that the National Green Tribunal has given direction to the Delhi Development Authority to constitute a special purpose vehicle. this special purpose vehicle is for the rejuvenation of Yamuna River. So based on this news article, today we'll discuss about the river Yamuna and its tributaries, and we'll also see about the directions given by National Green Tribunal. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. Now this river Yamuna originates from Yamunotri Glacier on the Bandher Poonch Peak in the Gadwal region of Uttarakhand. It flows parallel to the river Ganga and it joins Ganga at Prayagraj, that is the erstwhile Allahabad, and it joins Ganga as a right bank tributary. And this place is famously known as the Triveni Sangamam. And there the river creates the highly fertile alluvial Yamuna Ganges Doab region. Now you should note that Yamuna is also the longest tributary of river Ganga. Now let us see the tributaries of Yamuna. In its first 170 km stretch from its origin, the tributaries Rishi Ganga, Hanuman Ganga, Tones and Giri join the main river. And in this, Tones is the biggest and most extensive tributary of Yamuna. Then later if you see other big rivers such as Chambal, Sindh, Betwa and the Ken join Yamuna on its right bank. Then the rivers Hindon, Rind, Senga, Varuna etc. they join Yamuna on its left bank. So these are some of the main tributaries of Yamuna that you should know. And the Yamuna and its tributaries flow through the states of Uttarakhand, Himachal Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, National Capital Territory of Delhi, Haryana, Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh. And also know that the tributaries of Yamuna contribute 70.9% of the catchment area and the balance 29.1% accounted for direct drainage into the Yamuna River or to the smaller tributaries. And also the catchment basin of Yamuna River amounts to 10.7% of the total landmass of the country and it amounts to 40.2% of the Ganga basin. So these are the basic details that you should know with respect to Yamuna and its tributaries. Now the news is that the National Green Tribunal has directed the Delhi Development Authority to constitute a special purpose vehicle within 2 weeks and it is for the rejuvenation of Yamuna River. Now this decision of National Green Tribunal is based on the report submitted by Yamuna Monitoring Committee that was appointed by NGT. This Yamuna Monitoring Committee was appointed in 2018 to monitor and report the execution of NGT orders with respect to pollution control in the river Yamuna, with respect to the drains flowing into it from within Delhi, Haryana and Uttar Pradesh, and also on the rejuvenation of the Yamuna River. Now the report submitted by Yamuna Monitoring Committee highlights the inadequate progress by the governments of Delhi, UP and Haryana in rejuvenating the river in compliance with the previous NGT orders. So after observing the report, the National Green Tribunal has directed the concerned authorities to take steps in order to comply with the order. And as part of this only, the NGT directed the Delhi Development Authority to constitute the special purpose vehicle. Now this special purpose vehicle will carry out the ecological restoration of the floodplain zones of the river. It will also carry out the setting up of biodiversity parks, artificial wetlands and phytoremediation of drains at the river mouth locations. Now in this you should note that phytoremediation is one of the biological technologies that is used for the treatment of pollutants including heavy metals that are present in wastewater. In this method, the selected plant species are used to mitigate the environmental problems or pollutants from soil, air or water. There are many plant species that are commonly used such as vetiveria species, typha species and cypress species are some of the examples. Now apart from the wastewater treatment, the phytoremediation process also provides other advantages in terms of ecology, then green area, then reduced carbon footprint and also aesthetically it looks good. So this special purpose vehicle will also carry out this phytoremediation of drains at the river mouth locations. In addition to this, the SPV will also carry out activities such as creating ecological services by removing encroachments and also by developing the riverfront. In addition to this, NGT also directed the governments of Delhi, Haryana and Uttar Pradesh to take expeditious action on sewage treatment, industrial pollutants and solid wastes that are discharged into the river. So for this purpose, the NGT has given 2 weeks for the Delhi Development Authority. So now let us wait and see whether DDA takes appropriate actions or not for the rejuvenation of river Yamuna. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The split practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion. This discussion is based on this open editorial article and this article is focused on section 124A of IPC that deals with sedition. Now regarding this section 124A, the authors of this editorial have raised three major questions. The questions are regarding the usefulness of this section, its relevance in the current scenario, and who should repeal this section. So in this discussion, we'll see about the author's suggestions regarding these questions. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. Now first, you should know about the section 124A of Indian Penal Code. It deals with sedition. Sedition means conduct or speech inciting people to rebel against the authority of a state. If a person is convicted of sedition, then the person shall be punished with imprisonment for life or fine, or with imprisonment of 3 years or fine, or the person may just be punished with fine. Now the first question regarding this section is the usefulness of this sedition law. Now this question has arisen because, according to the authors, many sedition cases have been filed by the present political regime since Citizenship Amendment Act was passed. So here the authors are of the view that section 124A is misused by the government to suppress dissent or disagreement. They note that section 124A suppresses free speech and free thought of a citizen. Now as we saw it, this section penalizes the convicts with life imprisonment. But what actually happens is sedition cases are registered against the popular dissenters, and this charge acts as a deterrent for others to express their free speech and thought. And according to the authors, most of the cases that are filed even would not end in conviction at all. So they feel that sedition charges are useful tool in the hands of the police to suppress the freedom of speech. Now here the authors have mentioned that this section has been misused by the government because of the verdict of Supreme Court in the case law Kedarnath Singh versus State of Bihar, which is a 1962 case law. In this case, the Supreme Court held that the interpretation of the section 124A, it has to be against the state and not against the government. See, this section 124A mentions that disaffection towards the government established by law through words, signs, or any visible representation amounts to sedition. Now, in this, the term government established by law is the visible symbol of the state. Because this section has been included under Chapter 6 of Indian Penal Code, which is titled as Offenses Against the State. That is why Supreme Court held that here the term government established by law means the state and not the government. But still we can see that government uses this section on the ground that dissent is against its actions. So we can see that section 124A is being misused by the government. Now the next question is regarding the relevance of this section in the current scenario, or whether if this section has to be repealed or not. Here the authors are of the view that this section is a remain of colonial legacy. The Britishers used this section to suppress dissent against the state that was ruled by them. But after independence, the political leaders promised that this section would be repealed. But still today, this section exists. It exists because the political leaders think that if dissent goes beyond a certain point, then the administration must have the means to control that dissent. So based on this, the authors have differing views with respect to whether this section has to be repealed or not. One of the authors think that this section has to be repealed because the actual issue with this section is that it is administered by the police force. And as we already saw, all the cases do not end in conviction. So again, it is a burden to the judiciary only. And the government is also abusing this section. Hence, according to one of the authors, this section should be repealed. And it should be repealed by judiciary with a 5-member bench or more. One of the authors have suggested this because there is no political will to repeal this law in the parliament. But the other author thinks that this section need not be repealed. What she has suggested is that the judiciary must act towards protecting the fundamental rights of the citizens, such as the judiciary must protect Article 19 and Article 21 that deals with freedom of speech and protection of life and personal liberty. Now, this author does not want the section to be repealed because if this section is repealed now, then the political regime can misuse some of the other sections of IPC to suppress dissent. For example, they can use the section Criminal Conspiracy of Indian Penal Code. So rather than repealing this section, this author suggests that the judiciary should set up a search committee in every state, and the judge of the High Court of a respective state should suo motu quash the baseless sedition cases. That is, the judge of the High Court should quash the baseless sedition cases on their own. So these are some of the opinions of the authors who are advocates regarding this section 124A that deals with sedition. That is all about this discussion. The respect practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now let us take one question which is based on Employees Provident Fund. We have taken this question based on this news article which mentions about the reduction in interest rates for salaried employees under the Employment Provident Fund deposits. Now, in this, you should know that Provident Fund is a fund in which deposits of any classes of employees are received and the deposits are held on their individual accounts. So, employees give a portion of their salary to the Provident Fund and the employers, they must also contribute on behalf of their employees. And in India, if you see, the Employees Provident Fund comes under the Employees Provident Funds and Miscellaneous Provisions Act of 1952. Now, this act and the schemes which are coming under this act are managed by the Central Board of Trustees of EPF. And this board is assisted by the Employees Provident Fund organization. Now, in this board, that is the Central Board of Trustees, is a statutory body that is established under this 1952 act. And the board comes under the Ministry of Labour and Employment. And this board is a tripartite. It means it is represented by the government, both the central and the state governments, then by employers and also by the employees. So this makes the statement one as the correct statement, because it is a statutory body and the representatives are from central government, states, employers and employees. Now the second statement is EPF is applicable exclusively to all government establishment in India if they employ 20 or more persons. Now this statement is wrong because this act covers establishments both government and also private in which 20 or more persons are employed. So the correct answer to this question is option A, one only, because the question asks for the correct statement. Now also know that under this EPF scheme, an employee has to pay a certain contribution towards the scheme and an equal contribution is paid by the employer as we saw already. And according to section 12 of this act, the employer cannot deduct employer's share of PF from the wages of the employees. And if such deduction is made, then it is a criminal offense under this act. So when the employee retires, the employee gets a lump sum amount including their own contribution and the employer's contribution with interest on both. And it should be noted that this EPF is even applicable to contract employees. Contract employees were included in this scheme as per the Supreme Court order. We discussed about this order on our 20th January Hindu News analysis. So on a whole, this EPF scheme is a savings scheme for employees and the interest rate offered for their savings was 8.65% per annum till now. But based on today's news article, it mentions that the Central Board of Trustees has decided to reduce this percentage to 8.5% for the EPF deposits for the year 2019-2020. So that is all about this discussion. Now let us take up another question. This question asks, this course online platform recently seen in news is related to which among the following? Four options are given. Reporting model code of conduct violations during elections. National payment service platform. Complaints redress system of SEBI. Crime and criminal tracking network. Now in this, for reporting model code of conduct violations, the Election Commission of India introduced an app known as C-Vigil. So this is not the option. And the crime and criminal tracking network is known as the CCTNS and it is also not the correct answer. The correct answer to this question is complaints redress system of SEBI. We have taken this question based on this news article which mentions that SEBI has launched a mobile application that will allow entities to lodge grievances against the listed companies, market intermediaries and all categories of market participants. That is, the mobile version of Scores has been launched by SEBI. That is the news today. In this, Scores stands for SEBI Complaints Redress System. It is an online platform that was designed to help investors to lodge their complaints pertaining to securities market. They can lodge their complaints in the online mode with SEBI against the listed companies and SEBI registered intermediaries. And all the complaints received by SEBI against the listed companies and SEBI registered intermediaries are dealt through Scores only. So if you ask what are the complaints that come under the purview of SEBI, then the answer is the complaints which are arising out of issues that are covered under the SEBI Act, Securities Contract Regulation Act, Depositories Act, and then rules and regulations made under the Acts, and also the relevant provisions of Companies Act of 2013. Now the complaints that are arising out of the issues that are covered in these acts, then they come under the purview of SEBI. So remember that this course platform is like a grievance redressal mechanism for SEBI. Now let us discuss the questions that were displayed during the news article discussion session. This question is with respect to rivers. 5 rivers are given and the question asks which of the above are tributaries of Yamuna river. In this, the Rishi Ganga, Hanuman Ganga are tributaries of Yamuna river, but the option 3, which is Ram Ganga, it is a left bank tributary of river Ganga. And also Kishan Ganga, Dhauli Ganga, both are not tributaries of Yamuna river. Kishan Ganga is a tributary of Jhelum river and Dhauli Ganga is a left bank tributary of Kali river, which is also known as Sarda river, and this Kali river is a tributary to Ghagra river, which is a tributary to Ganga river. So the correct answer to this question is option D, 1 and 2 only. Also know that Chambal, Sindh, Betwa, Kane, they are major right bank tributaries of Yamuna river, and then Hindon, Rind, Senga and Varuna are left bank tributaries of Yamuna river. Now this question asks, exciting or attempting to excite disaffection by signs or by visible representation, bringing or attempting to bring into hatred or contempt towards the government established by law in India amounts to which of the following? Criminal conspiracy, defamation, sedition, rioting. Now this definition is the definition of sedition. So the correct answer is option C. This definition is as per section 124 capital A of Indian Penal Code. Now this next question is with reference to polyhouses. The first statement is polyhouses are structures that uses glass, timber and polyethylene. Now this statement is wrong because polyhouses are structures that uses only polyethylene, not glass and timber. Now the second statement is greenhouse is a type of polyhouse. Now this statement is also wrong because it should be the other way, that is polyhouse is a type of greenhouse. Greenhouse is a generic term that uses glass, timber and polyethylene, whereas polyhouse uses the polyethylene. So polyhouse is the type of greenhouse, not the other way around. Here both the statements are incorrect and the question asks for the incorrect statement. So the correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Now let us take one mains question based on GS paper 2. Free speech is one of the most significant principles of democracy. Article 19 of Indian Constitution declares freedom of speech as a basic fundamental right. However, reasonable restrictions can always be imposed on this right in order to ensure its responsible exercise by the citizens. In the light of the above statements, examine the relevance of section 124 capital A of Indian Penal Code. Now, this is the section for sedition. So, you have to discuss the freedom of speech with relevance to sedition and how sedition charges restrict freedom of speech in our country. Let us take another mains question based on GS paper 2. The Freedom in the World report released by US-based NGO has said that democracy and pluralism are under assault across the world. The Democracy Index 2019 also said that the global score of democracy has come down. What could be the reasons for the downfall of democracy? Suggest some measures to revive democratic values globally. Now, this question mentions about two reports, so you can write some points with respect to these reports. This report is released by Freedom House, whereas the Democracy Index is released by Economist Intelligence Unit. And both these reports mentions about downfall of democratic values. So the question asks for the reasons for the downfall of democracy. You can mention reasons such as decline in civil liberties, including media freedom and freedom of speech, etc. Then the question also asks you to suggest some measures to revive democratic values globally. Here you can mention points like respecting, protecting and fulfilling human rights, then emphasizing democracy strengthening programs in foreign assistance, etc. You can write answers for both these questions and post it in the comment section. We will review it and appropriate suggestion will be given in a reasonable time period.
With this, we have come to the end of today's Hindi news analysis. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.